As we all know, I'm sure, women still earn less than men, and there are still more men named John in the C-suite than there are women. Yes, we have a revolution underway in the business culture as a result of the Me Too movement. 5 women are running for president. A 29-year-old phenom is making waves on the left, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, and an extremely effective 79-year-old woman is Speaker of the House. So the question is, are we at a new inflection point for women in positions of power, and how do women attain power, and do they wield it? To dig into this timely topic this morning, it's my pleasure to welcome 4 incredible women to the stage, women who have broken political boundaries, anchored major news outlets, led television networks, and created incredible advances within the world of communications. They've also refused to let any obstacles bar them from their many outstanding accomplishments. So please, ladies, join me on stage. Give a warm welcome to Congresswoman Mia Love. Author and Washington Post columnist Sally Quinn. Founder of USA Network, Kay Koplovitz. And editor of Air Mail, Alessandra Stanley. So I want to start by just letting you guys talk a bit about this still dearth of women in positions of powers in the corporate world and beyond. Give us a sort of status report and where we need, what you see as the priorities moving forward. Let's start with you.
Oh, well, in my field, I think there's too many women. I think business is sort of the last place where women are really having a hard time, but in my experience, in your experience, I mean, Mia's experience, the changes in our lifetime have been so enormous. There are more women than men practically in journalism now. You know, more women going to medical school, more women going to law school. So why business has been a little tougher? I don't know, maybe it's just because it's men really want to make money.
Kay?
Yes, well, people often ask me what it was like to be a CEO at a young age and start a company that grew into a multi-billion dollar business, and they said, well, you know, what is it like to be a woman, and how do you get to be a CEO? And I said, first you start there, and everything else kind of pales in comparison. So I'm about women and economic power, and how women are starting companies and growing big companies, not just home-based businesses, which are great, small business, which are great. We're about big business at Springboard Enterprises, and I can talk a little bit about it, but I really think that it is time for women to grab the economic power and use that power to change policy, to change what it's like in a corporate environment. Just a little, a couple little points of interest, I think. First of all, Doug Peterson from S&P Global recently on an interview in CNBC said that if women in the United States had the same jobs, the same status as women in Norway, it would change the GDP of this country by $1.6 trillion. That's economic power. On a global scale, it would be $5.8 trillion. So that's economic power. So we can think about what women are doing, what we're doing in corporate America, what we're doing in entrepreneurship. I think that's really important. And another study done by McKinsey said that if women, men and women, and talk about education, women come to the marketplace with more education than men on the average across. They go into corporations at the same rate, but at the first promotion, 100 men are promoted and 79 women are promoted. And then the next promotion, the gap grows every time. So you get to the C-suite and only 5% of women are at the top of corporations that are like public big corporations. So it's really, you know, it's very interesting, but women have economic power, and I'll talk a little bit more, I'll let others talk, but I want to bring to light something that I think is really important about gaining wealth and economic power for women.
I would like to dig into that too. Sally, give us a sense of how you see the landscape.
You know, I don't really know anything about corporate power because I have never had any experience in that, but what I have had experience in is political power in Washington, because that's where I live. And I've worked for the Washington Post for 50 years.
And you've been a keen political observer.
I've been covering power, how people go after power, how they achieve power, how they use it and abuse it, and how they lose it. And so watching how women, and it's politics and journalism, as Alessandra said, have risen in the world of power politics and power journalism is very different from the corporate world. And as Alessandra said, there are almost as many, if not more, women in journalism now than there are. And I don't see, a good story is a good story.
Yeah.
Whoever gets the story is the one who's going to be the star.
And yet, while representation matters, I would question, Alessandra, recently I saw a stat about pay disparity and gender equity when it comes to pay. And the industries, when you break it down, the number one industry of pay equity gap is media.
Right.
Well, right. So sure, there are a lot of female journalists, but if we're being underpaid or underrepresented in that way, in the power structure way,
it's unacceptable.
Right, unacceptable, right?
But politics, and I think we really have Nancy Pelosi to thank for this, who is the ultimate role model, as far as I can see. I mean, she's a genius, and she has had this power all of her life, and wielded it in the most intelligent way, which is that she hasn't changed who she is. She's just been this woman who has power. And she's not like, you don't look at her and say, oh, there's a powerful woman. You look at her and say, there is a woman who has power. And I think she's changed the way so many women look at power in political power.
Right.
And look at the people who we have running for office now, and I think a lot of it is because of Nancy.
It's very important. Yes.
Well, I can just draw from my experience. I started my career in my background is marketing. I worked for a company doing their voice over IP product management. And as soon as I had a child, it was always just my role to make sure I took a step back. Now, look, I took that on gladly. But even through that and taking care of my children and having children, I ran for city council, ran a city, brought it from 5,000 to 27,000 people in less than 4 years, making sure that that city, I got it out of the brink of bankruptcy to a thriving city. And when I ran for Congress, which, by the way, it took a lot of convincing for me to run for Congress, I was labeled as not experienced enough or not educated enough, even though I have a four-year degree. And my opponent actually didn't even got his GED. For some reason, it was just I wasn't experienced enough or educated enough. And even running for Congress, it's almost like you had to do twice as much. You had to continue to rise to the occasion. And so I would say this: if the United States is not, if the United States Congress and the policymakers doesn't mirror what's happening in the corporate world, it's no wonder that women are still, like, we've made great strides, but we're still behind.
Right.
There was a poll that actually came out, it was actually a study by Georgetown University that said that 13% of Americans still believe that women are emotionally unequipped to run for office or be able to have the emotional capacity to deal with office. That doesn't make any sense to me. It doesn't make any sense.
Right. I mean, you're dealing with a lot of unconscious bias is what you're talking about. But I'm wondering, as a legislator, if you have particular initiatives that you think might work in the area of sort of equal pay, equal rights in whatever realm we're talking about.
I think that if we don't get to the basics, then there's no way that we can get. It's almost like trying to fix Z without going and fixing ABC. What I mean by that is, as a Republican, I remember trying to put forth a bill that allowed for women to get access
to birth control over the counter. And I actually got pushback from my own male colleagues, and all of our women were actually on board. It's really interesting to me that Republican women were on board, but I'm talking about basic health issues, basic being able to have control of that. If you don't have, if you're not fixing A, B, and C, how can you expect women to be equipped to deal with the rest of it? And I think that it's almost just trying to fix the basics. If we don't do that, then we're not going to be able to move ahead any further than
Sorry, that. Alessandra, I cut you off. Go ahead.
No, I was just saying, you said 13% of men?
They said 13% of Americans.
But I know, but that's very low. I mean, 13% believe that the moon is made out of cheese. I mean, that's a pretty great
number. So what I mean by that is when you're looking at something like that, by the way, that number doubles when it comes to Republicans. So if you're looking at that and you're looking at a close race, there are a certain percentage of Americans that won't even look at a woman just because she is a woman.
Yeah.
And that number has changed from 2014 to 2018. So I'm not saying that we've made men do not have that comparison. Women are at a 13% disadvantage already.
Yeah. Well, let me talk about a couple of the issues that we've heard about. I mean, I've been in television news for 30 years, and I've heard about the pipeline issue for 30 years, that it's about getting women in the pipeline, getting women in the right positions. And I feel like after 30 years, there is a pipeline, or there should be a pipeline. I feel like that's a tired excuse. We talk about sort of pay equity in this modern age of Me Too. How much do you think transparency would help or hurt in that initiative? I'm just throwing out issues out there for you to, you know, sort of...
Well, I think transparency would help a lot. See, women have not had the same access to the information about what other people are making for decades. It's been opaque. And transparency would at least allow women to understand better the marketplace. And some corporations are better at that now. There has been a move in some corporations to really be much more transparent. I know when I was on the board of CA Technologies, which was sold last year, but for 5 years, CA was working to get women in their marketplace on par with pay. And it takes time to understand where the barriers are, what they're doing wrong, and to correct it. And so that is, you know, it. But at 5 years, 5 years later, after working to correct the differences, they got women at parity, at pay in the company. And so companies can do that. But it's a very deliberate process that they have to undergo. I mean, Salesforce is taking action on that part and being very vocal about what they're doing to try to even up the pay in the marketplace. We need leaders in corporate America to do that.
And it's literally what Lilly Ledbetter, it's what triggered her suit, was there was a lack of transparency that she was not getting paid the same as her colleagues, and she wasn't allowed to know that. Yeah. Sally, let's dig into some of the female presidential candidates, right? There are five, you know, very sort of highly touted women, and yet it seems to be the men who are gathering all the headlines. There was a lot of sort of post-election analysis after 2016 about the amount of media coverage and the type of coverage of Hillary versus Donald Trump. And so the question I have to you is, do you think the women are getting the same kind of spotlight? Do you think they're positioning themselves in the ways that perhaps the men are seen in this race?
Well, you know, it's really... There was a piece in the New York Times last week about women and likability, and that women had to be more likable than men. And I'm not sure that I agree with that, because I think that there are plenty of men who are not particularly likable.
You can name a lot.
Yeah, name a lot, yeah.
Kay says she can name a lot.
And there are women who are. I mean, I mentioned Nancy Pelosi, who's very likable. I mean, I would vote for her for president tomorrow. But. So I really don't think that's as much of an issue, and is why they're getting the men are getting attention. I think it comes back to you're a journalist. It's what's the story?
Yeah.
What's a good story? Now, Beto O'Rourke was a great story. I mean, he ran against the most horrible person in Congress, and actually almost won. I mean, he was this guy from Texas. And he was skateboarding and standing on tables, and you know, and then he was in Vanity Fair. That's a story, you know. And Mayor Pete is a story, and Joe Biden, for because of age and all other kinds of things, is a story. And look at Bernie Sanders. I mean, Bernie Sanders is you know, Curb Your Enthusiasm. You know, I mean, Bernie Sanders is on Saturday Night Live. Those, I mean, and he's easily made fun of and easily satirized. Where the women, although I must say Saturday Night Live did a pretty good job with Elizabeth Warren this weekend, but the women are not as good a story. I mean, Amy Klobuchar is, everybody likes Amy Klobuchar, except that there's been...
Mia, you're shaking your head.
I don't agree. I don't necessarily, I mean, I don't disagree, but I think that a lot of these women have really good stories. I think that we are still, as Americans, if you look at the current president, older white male, you look at the two top Democrat presidential candidates, older white male. I think that people look and say, okay, there's wisdom, there's stability, and I think that has to shift a little bit in the United States. I think that the women that are out there have great stories. I may not agree with them on policy, but I think that they have great stories, and they have a lot of ideas that they can bring to the table.
You know, it used to be in TV, it was all about ratings, and so now with journalism, you know, it's all about how many hits you get, you know. And so you can write a piece about Amy Klobuchar and it doesn't get that many hits. And you write a piece about Beto or Mayor Pete, who's getting all of the attention for obvious reasons. And he gets a lot, you know, and it ends up being all about money. What's the story and how many people are gonna be interested in it? And you can say all these women have great stories, but if their stories are boring and people aren't reading them or watching them, then it doesn't matter. So I think as a journalist, I mean, I know who I want to cover, who I want to write about, who I want to interview, and they're not the people who I think are particularly, I don't want to interview people who are not particularly interesting. I mean, I really think it comes down to that.
But is that agenda setting? Is that gatekeeping in a way? Is an interesting question. You had your hand up, Kay. Sorry.
Yeah, I mean, I don't want to get off the track of journalism, but storytelling is really extremely important. And it always, coming from the media myself, I mean, I really do understand the value of story. When we get into women entrepreneurs, I wanted to just share a few points with you. Back in 99, when all that money was pouring over the transom, we're talking about real economic power in the venture capital world, there were no women. It was all men getting $104 billion worth of capital, and I said, this can't be. We can't always be under starvation for capital. Women raising money to run for office still have the same problem. Right. And in the 19 years since then, with 769 entrepreneurial companies led by women coming through our accelerator program, they together have raised $9.5 billion and created enormous amount of wealth for themselves, their investors. You know some of these companies, iRobot, Constant Contact, Minute Clinic. By the way, Minute Clinic was the start of the transformation of CVS. They bought it and now they're a urgent care center, not a drugstore. They're, you know, iRobot, Zipcar, lots of companies coming up. What I wanted to say about the economic power of women and how I think it relates to politics and policy is that women entrepreneurs raising equity capital return 2 times per dollar raised, 2 times the revenue per dollar raised of men in the same class. And I think that this is indicative of how women manage at the corporate level and how women in policy and politics spend our capital, our taxpayer capital. I love the fact that so many more women got elected to office, and I think if we elect more women to office, I think it'll translate into better stewardship of how our capital is deployed for basic things like healthcare.
Okay, you're absolutely right. I mean, time and time again,
they relate to one another.
Yeah, time and time again, there's been research that shows that companies that have good representation have better return on investment, have better profitability, have better dividend returns. But I want to get back to this idea of unconscious bias a little bit, because you mentioned venture capital. There was this great study done out of I think it was UPenn, one of the great business schools. They had a venture capital panel, and it was a script and a slideshow voiced by a man, and the exact same script and a slideshow voiced by a woman. And I can't remember the exact numbers, but it was literally like the man got funding 60% of the time and the woman got funding less than 30% of the time. And it was the exact same idea, exact same slideshow. And it really just speaks to, I think, the intransigence of sort of the lack of this pipeline.
Well, I can tell you, women on par in the same industries raising capital out there raise 30% less than men and return higher return on capital to their investors. It's very, very clear. And if people say, oh, isn't that great? Women don't need as much money to really perform on their businesses. And I say, how would they perform if they had as much capital? Because I know they're not going to waste it. I see, because I work with companies all over the world led by women that are changing industries, transforming industries, and their deployment of capital is just so much more precise than men. And it's not to denigrate men, it's just to say women really are a great investment. They're a great investment in policy, in politics, in corporate America, and in entrepreneurship. I think, you know, it's our turn, and I feel we've got to grab the power while we have some momentum, and that's what we need to do now.
I have to say that I wholeheartedly agree with that, but I think it's important that we look and know the value of women being involved on the corporate side and in politics on both sides of the aisle. As we saw a major increase on the Democrat side, we saw a decrease on the Republican side, and I'm not talking, and it's mainly, there are a lot of times I look at my colleagues and I was like, we have to do better here. We have to speak to everyone here, and it's that instead of just a group of people. I have to say that I think that we are making strides. My story is a young lady whose parents came from Haiti with $10 in their pockets and worked really hard, and I'm a product of that work, and I ended up being the first black female ever elected as a Republican.
From Utah.
States, from Utah.
Incredible.
And so, but I had to work twice as hard, and I'm okay with that. And women are in the pipeline, but all I need to say is that women are so capable. They do. The return on investment in policy and in life and in funding is incredible. And so I stop giving each other a hard time, because I also think that women give each other a hard time. In the state of Utah, I got this a lot. If they couldn't send themselves to Washington, how could they send another female to Washington?
Absolutely.
So we need to stop that.
I just want to say, getting back to the story, I mean, a lot of the younger women, I know a lot of younger journalists in their 20s and 30s, and they are very powerful women, and a lot of them are heads of websites, and I mean, they're just taking off. And you look at somebody like AOC, and when you talk about why are the women not getting coverage, my God, I mean, she's gotten more coverage than anybody else.
But a lot of that is she's become a lightning rod.
Right, but she's also a woman, and she's a strong woman. And
sure.
She's getting, but I had this very interesting...
Which arguably is why she's often attacked.
Right. But I was at the British Embassy about a month ago, and I was talking to Maureen Dowd and Andrea Mitchell when Kellyanne Conway came over, and she started attacking us, the press, for writing about her problems with George, her husband, who is tweeting all these horrible things about Donald Trump. You know, he's a moron, he's an idiot, he needs to be impeached, and this kind of thing. And she was saying, I think this is, you all are being very anti-feminist for writing about this, because I am a person in my own right, and I have achieved all of this, and I have my own job and my own identity, and I don't know why, you know, I don't know why you think that you have to write about this when it is very anti-feminist, because my husband has nothing to do with my husband. And I said, well, Kellyanne, it's a story. And she didn't understand that. She kept saying, well, but, you know, George is jealous of me. He's jealous of me. He can't stand the fact that I'm a star and he's not. And that's what you all are writing about, and it isn't fair. Well, I think that's a good story, and I think it's a good story about Washington, too, is that Kellyanne Conway is a star, if you want to call it that, and her husband is not. And so you see the, you know, you see the balance in power changing a lot, and how it affects, well, certainly marriages, but also how it affects the press, because the press is never going to stop writing about it.
Interesting. Alessandra.
I agree with you. It's a better story. But there's something else which is sort of a cautionary tale, which is that so often for a woman to succeed, first a man must fail. I mean, I'm thinking of Susan Zirinsky taking over at CBS. But first, many, many men had to be disgraced. And that you get a job when it's not as worthwhile as it used to be. I mean, to be CBS in its heyday was the most important network, the most important news place. By the time a woman gets to have it, it's shrunk in significance, in worth.
How do you see? I'm sorry to cut you off, Kay, but we have to wrap up. But I just want to follow up with you. How do you think the Me Too movement has affected sort of power structures and will continue to do so?
Well, I think that's the perfect example. You know, I mean, it toppled the top guy, but the institution itself is also diminished. So, you know, the reason I bring this up is I'm thinking, you know, the sad thing will be we'll have a woman president, but the country that Trump will leave us with will be diminished, and it's almost a job not worth having. Not just to cheer everybody up.
I do think the Me Too movement has done something. It has shifted the belief in stories, and it's had a negative aspect to it. There's a backlash to it, but the positive thing about it is that the shift has happened in a sense that we used to always believe the accused. The accused couldn't have done that. The accused always got the benefit of, well, being accused but not being convicted or being, you know, really castigated or losing stature for it. Now, people are beginning to, you know, have, because of Me Too, begun to accept the fact that people, the accusers, are being believed. And so there's a shift.
There is a shift.
And I think that's the important part about it. And the most important part is, what are we going to do for the future? Because we can't change the past.
Okay, we have to wrap up. I know you wanted to say something about backlash. I'll give you the last word, Sally, but we literally have to stop after that. Go ahead.
Look, there's some backlash when it comes to the Me Too movement, but it's also given us an opportunity. Anything bad that happens actually gives us an opportunity to rise to the occasion. That means that as a parent, I have uncomfortable conversations with my girls and making sure that they are not victims ever. In terms of their stance and what they believe in and knowing their rights and what's appropriate and not appropriate, but also means that I have a very frank conversation with my young son also and how to treat women. And what I'd like to say to end all of this is that we are absolutely capable. We need to do what men do. Look in the mirror and say, you know what, I can do this job, I can do it better. And I know it's gonna be a sacrifice, because more times it's a sacrifice to women than it is to men to run for office, but stand up, because corporate America normally, they need women involved in politics. And so I would say, women, it's time for people on both sides of the aisle, think for yourselves, stand up and rise to the occasion, because America needs you.
Okay, Sally, final thoughts.
I think one of the things that I've learned from being around all of these younger women who are very powerful in Washington is their whole different attitude they have about themselves, which is, I've got all the power. I mean, they feel powerful, and they are, and they project that power, so people buy into it. And I think that has made a huge difference. Just how you present yourself
absolutely
is a huge deal.
Thank
and
you.
I think these young women are walking into a room and they own it and everybody feels it.
I think that's absolutely right. Thank you so much, Sally. Thank you, ladies, so much for your insights. I appreciate it. I can hear Helen Reddy. I Am Woman, Hear Me Roar. Thank you, ladies.